وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. We have reached the hadith number 24 from the 40 Nawawis, which is the 40 hadith compiled by Imam Nawawi rahimahullah. This hadith narrated by Abi Dharr al-Ghifari, Abi Dharr al-Ghifari radiyallahu anhu, the great Sahabi. He mentioned that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, فِيمَا يَرْوِيهِ عَنْ رَبُّهِ. This hadith we're going to talk about today. This hadith, one of the greatest hadith. As Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he said, this hadith, أشرف hadith, رواه أهل الشام. This hadith, the most honorable and noble hadith, the people of Sham have narrated this hadith. One of the narrators, which is Abu Idris al-Khawlani, he said, when he was reciting the hadith, he sat on his knees. He kneeled down and sat there. Because this hadith, he felt how great, because the hadith talking about who's Allah. Mention who's Allah. As Ayat al-Kursi, the greatest ayah in the Quran. The greatest ayah in the Quran, Ayat al-Kursi. Because this describing who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. As Surah Al-Ikhlas, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. This is equivalent to one third of the Quran. Why? Because talking about who is Allah. So is this hadith talk or explain to us, describing who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have said, فِيمَا يَرْوِيهِ عَنْ رَبُّهُ عن ربه فيما يرويه عن ربه. The hadith narrated this hadith called hadith al-Qudsi. Hadith Qudsi. We have the Quran, we have regular hadith, which is we said Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam have said, and we said Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that Allah have said beside the Quran. They call this hadith hadith al-Qudsi. Hadith al-Qudsi. And the hadith al-Qudsi, okay, we know the Quran, Allah have spoke the Quran directly. That Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam memorized it from Jibreel and he delivered it to us exactly the way it is. Allah spoke the Quran, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he truly spoke the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Quran is not created. Allah spoke it. Literally, Allah have spoke the Quran. So one of the attributes of Allah, that he speaks. Allah have mentioned, Allah have talked to Musa clearly. وَكَلَّمْ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. He spoke to Musa, عليه السلام. Alright? وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ الْمَلَائِكَ. Allah have said to the Malaika. So Allah speaks. This one of the attributes for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the hadith Qudsi, beside the Quran, we said the Quran, said the regular hadith we know, and the hadith Qudsi, and the scholars have differ. Is the hadith Qudsi, is like the Quran, Allah spoke it, and told Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam exactly, literally the hadith as was narrated here, or this the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he gave the meaning for the hadith. So Allah told the hadith and Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam gave the meaning. Definitely the scholars, he said, the ma'na, the meaning, exactly what Allah wants. Now here, the wording, whether from Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam or from Allah directly, exactly the same word by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the scholar has differs, and the mean, most likely this is the meaning of the hadith. But there's opinion, this is exactly the hadith what Allah have mentioned. So this is the hadith Qudsi. Allah have said something, revealed to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam beside the Quran. They call it hadith Qudsi. And hadith Qudsi definitely totally different than the Quran. We don't recite the hadith Qudsi in the salah. We'll invalidate our salah. We don't every word we read from Hadith Qudsi, you get the Hasan and Hasan multiplied by 10, like the Quran. The Quran, every letter you read, the Hasan multiplied by 10. Hadith Qudsi different, all right? So Hadith Qudsi, we don't recite it to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just we read it, we understand it, and we apply it. The Quran, we read every time with the Quran, there's Hasanat for that. So here this beautiful hadith, we said this is the greatest or the most noble hadith Allah had, I mean the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or the people of Sham have narrated on behalf of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, عن أبي ذر الغفاري رضي الله عنه عن نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيما يرويه عن ربه. So what he had narrated from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قال يا عبادي. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يا عبادي, O my slaves. When you hear the word, O my slave, Allah call you with something, trying to soften your hearts. يا عبادي, O my slave. The most honorable title you have as a human being, you are slave to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the most honorable title you have. You are slave to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah wants to soften one's heart. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was called, said, وَأَنَّهُ لَمَّا قَامَ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ يَدْعُوهُ سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ. Praise due to the one who made Isra with his slave, meaning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. بِعَبْدِهِ, the abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah called him, he's my slave. So Allah, when he wants to honor a person, said, my abd, my slave. من المسجد الحرامي إلى المسجد الأقصى. And here shows here, Allah wants to soften our hearts. He said here, يا عبادي, more than 10 times mentioned, يا عبادي, يا عبادي, يا عبادي, يا عبادي. I counted, I think it was 11 times even. يا عبادي, the word يا عبادي, oh my slaves, it was mentioned the hadith 11 times. Think about this, Allah wants to soften our hearts. Said, يا عبادي, إني حرمت الظلم على نفسي. Said, I have forbidden injustice upon myself. He made injustice haram for himself, subhanAllah. So do not oppress one another. Do not oppress one another. This is long, beautiful hadith, shows the mercy and the fairness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's how haram the dhulm. So shows here all the hadith, think about it from the beginning, and just want to remember this, revolve around acknowledging who's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Acknowledging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, talk about the oneness of Lordship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the oneness of Godhood, the oneness of the attribute, the names and the attributes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala show us who is He, who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and shows that Allah capable to commit injustice, but because his fairness like so perfect, he will not be unjust or unjust. He will never oppress the people, even though he can. Shows he can, he's capable, but he will not do it. Say it's haram for himself. He made it haram for himself. He made the rules and made it haram for himself. Let's say it was hasha wa kalla, there's no way Allah to be dhalim, unjust, but if he was unjust, so who's going to do anything about it? What can you do? That shows how the fairness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And no one could hold us accountable for if he was the subhanallah, if he was unjust. But by or with his grace, he forbidden injustice upon himself and made it haram among one another, among us. And even Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he sent Mu'ad radiallahu anhu to Yemen, he said, oh Mu'ad, you are going to invite people of Ahl al-Kitab, Yehud and Christian in Yemen. He said, subhanAllah, he said, and beware of the supplication, the dua against you from the mazlum, the oppressor one, the oppressed one, the mazlum. He goes, فَإِنَّهُ لَيْسَ بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَ اللَّهِ. There's no barrier between the dua of the oppressed one and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Means Allah will answer his dua. If you were unfair to the kafir, if he made dua, Allah will answer it. So fairness, something is not optional, something mandatory upon us, subhanAllah. And we see here, sometimes you see things around you, say, why this happened? How come this happened to this people? They have this and have that. For example, the earthquake in Syria and Turkey, especially in Syria, said, do they need this too? After what they had to go through, 12 years of war, killing and so on, being dealt with in the most brutal way. SubhanAllah, Allah is the most wise. Allah is the most merciful. There's wisdom behind anything. Because Shaitan was, why this happened to this people? Young children, old people, and so on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us. Remember, the one who dies upon tawheed, upon his salah, siyam, zakah, and so on, he will die as a shaheed. You're going to die anyways. So look at, and even death could be a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this when you feel like subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-hakim al-alim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most wise, the most knowledgeable, the one who does things the way he wants, in the best way of course, way beyond what you and I could think, and above our imagination, you feel at ease. So we are under the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful. So how could people be unjust to one another? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described that in the farewell hajj. So basically shedding their blood, the spreading rumors, backbiting, instigating between the brothers and so on, or taking the wealth or the money of your brother without any justifications. So this should be zalim or unjust to your brother or your sister. So the rest of the things will make you zalim. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have mentioned, and remember this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive if you owe your brother some rights, if you oppressed your brother. Allah forgive all sins except for shirk. Even shirk, if you repent before you die, Allah forgives that. In Allah does not forgive shirk. He forgive whatever beneath that or less than that. But the shirk, if you have made tawbah, repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah accept this. But the thing is, if you took someone's wealth, for example, it's not going to work for sin. Asking Allah for forgiveness. You need to ask that person's forgiveness. If you owe him, you have to give it to him. Otherwise, on the day of judgment, this, the dhulm, will be settled in the day of judgment when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judge between the people. He will take from your hasanat, as Rasulullah mentioned the hadith, said, do you know who is the bankrupt? He said, the one who doesn't have money or whatever properties. No, he said, no, the one who have hasanat. So, and with the hadith, we don't want to go to the hadith, but definitely he will be taken from your hasanat, till if you end up finish your hasanat, he will be thrown some of his sayyat upon you. وَلَيَّذُ بِاللَّهِ. So this is the bone. Then he said, يَا عِبَادِي, again, oh my slave, my servants, كُلُّكُمْ ضَال. He said, you're all misguided. Every single one's misguided. He said, إِلَّا مَنْ هَدَيْتُهُ, except for, just one, the one who I have guided. Everyone's misguided except for those I have guided. فَاسْتَهْدُونِي, ask me for guidance. I will guide you. أَهْدِكُمْ. So ask me for guidance, then I'll guide you, subhanAllah. And here, we all in need for the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every one of us, including Prophet and messengers and so on, we all in need for him. Even he told Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he found you misguided, then he guided you. To Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, meaning that misguided, he doesn't know the Sharia, he doesn't know the rules of Islam, then he taught him. Allah told Rasulullah وَكَانَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ عَظِيمًا. Allah told Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the favor upon you is so great. Upon everyone, he chose him as a prophet. He chose all the prophets to become prophets. So they're all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, including the prophet. So when you see someone guided, say, why? I mean, already guided. Why should I ask for more guidance? The scholar said either to be more guided, because no matter how much guided you are, you never can reach the level it's supposed to be. Because Rasulullah himself, he said, I will not enter Jannah unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower me with his mercy. Right? So imagine people like us. So either to be guided more and more, and second one, he said, to be steadfast upon guidance. Because a lot of people, they seem like on the straight path, and they divert away from the right path. So that's why Rasulullah ﷺ always think about this hadith we have mentioned many times. Rasulullah ﷺ, the one who used, the best man ever created, the best worshipper, the best abid Rasulullah ﷺ ever was created. And he said, oh Allah, the one who turns the heart, the one who flips the heart, make my heart steadfast and you upon your deen. And then steadfast, we said to increase your guidance or to steadfast upon the guidance or to be guided in the future also. For the right things. So in the Surah Al-Fatiha, we the Sunnah to make two rak'ah. Jazakallah. So the Sunnah, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we recite the Fatiha every day 17 times minimum with the obligatory Salah. The obligatory is 17 rak'ah. Each one we start, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Oh Allah, guide us to the straight path. So the thing is here, we need to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance. As he said, you all misguided except for the one who I have guided. Ask me for guidance, then I'll guide you. Mean it, we said, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Ask Allah, don't think, don't ever be like so confident, I'm good, I'm done, it's over. No, no, no. We are need for guidance. As that's why one of the greatest surah, the greatest surah of the Quran, Fatiha, part of it, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم, or Allah guide us to the straight path. Then he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ya ibadi, again, oh my slaves, soften our hearts. He said, kullukum ja'a, subhanallah, kullukum ja'a, you all hungry. He said, illa man at'amtu, except for those the one I have fed. He said, فَاسْتَطْعِمُونِي, seek food from me, I'll feed you. SubhanAllah. Think about this. Even if you have food, if you're sick, you cannot eat it. Some people, they have food, but they're sick, they cannot eat. Some people, they can eat, but they don't have food. Who removed the hardship? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who gave this one food? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who was make this one able to eat? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in many surah, said, فَلْيَنْظُرْ الْإِنسَانِ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِهِ أَنَّا صَبَبْنَا الْمَاءَ صَبَّا ثُمَّ شَقَقْنَا الْأَرْضَ شَقَّا فَأَنْبَتْنَا مِنْهَا حَبًّا and so on. So the thing is, and the other ayats, when you think about, when you plant the seeds in the ground, many people plant the seeds, but not everyone get the same crop, right? Some people, they get some harvest, some people doesn't. So Allah, the one who make this a grow. So from the beginning with, we said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're all hungry, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help, without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will, nothing gonna grow. You end up with nothing. Even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, look at the water. Who brought it down from the Muslim, from the clouds? Allah. So you end up with no water. So the thing is, all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who feed us. Then he said, كلكم يا عباد, again, oh my slave, you all are naked, except those the one have, I have a cloth. So ask me for a clothing, I would clothe you, subhanAllah. First of all, even the clothes you have, who gave you the money to buy? Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who have guided you to wear clothes? Who guided the first one, our father Adam, to wear clothes? So this ni'mah, and you feel wallahi the ni'mah when you are in Hajj or Umrah. When you wear the haram clothes, you wish you missed this clothes. You wear it for something, for a day or two, whatever, a few hours, then you miss the clothes. You feel the ni'mah, the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you have a clothes. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and that's Allah have said, you all naked except for the one I have clothed, so ask me to clothe you, I would do so. So without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help, you're not gonna have a clothes. Then he said, shows here definitely how much we are in need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for even to have our clothes or something. Then he said, Ya ibadi, innakum tukhti'una bil-layl wal-nahar. Oh my slaves, you commit sin during the day and during the night. Imagine Allah said, oh my slave, you commit the sins during the day and the night. I have heard one of the scholars, he said, subhanAllah, said, imagine your boss telling you, you have made mistakes, you have been making mistakes. You did this and this and this and that. During the day when you are working day shift or night shift, then you make mistake. When you morning shift, you make mistake. Night shift, you make mistakes. So what do you expect from your boss? Goodbye, like Mu'az said, right? But look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If your boss telling you, Mahdi, you have been making mistakes every single day, in the night and the day, what do you think you're going to do? Fire. Look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but this Allah, we're not comparing, subhanAllah. He said, oh my slave, you commit mistakes during the night and the day, وَأَنَا أَغْفِرُ الدُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا, and I'll forgive all sins. So that's Allah. See, that's the hadith. I said this is the hadith, the most noble hadith, one of the most noble hadith, because it describes who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. You make the mistakes, subhanAllah, you do this and this and that, and you admit you have, there's no way around it. Then that subhanAllah, then news comes to see you, subhanAllah, and I forgive all sins. Instead of being fired, no, I'm the forgiver, come to me. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. So by default, all humans are sinners. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in the hadith Qudsi again, said every son of Adam is a sinner. And the best among those, the one who repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, and no one can forgive you but Allah. So ask for forgiveness, he said. Ask for forgiveness. فَاسْتَغْفِرُونِي I'll forgive you. Ask for forgiveness, I'll forgive you, subhanAllah. And no one gonna forgive you but Allah. So never despair of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at this here, just this portion of this hadith. We agree and we admit that we are sinners, then we go there and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, subhanAllah, He will forgive us. Then He said, Ya ibad again, O my slaves, innakum lam tablighu durri. Said, qal fatadurruni. He said, O my slave, you're never gonna attain to harm me. And before the forgiveness, I just want to mention something I forgot, just remember. Think about Rasulullah has mentioned the hadith, as-salah ila as-salah, between each salah and jum'ah to jum'ah on Ramadan and Ramadan, all the minor sins are forgiven. So you prayed Maghrib, you sit here at Isha, so whatever between Maghrib and Isha, your sins are forgiven. You prayed jum'ah, from jum'ah to jum'ah, your sins are forgiven. By next jum'ah, all the sins are between the minor sins. This is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After He said, you may commit mistakes day and night. We are by default are sinners. And we all sinners, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, subhanAllah, show as long, of course the major sins will be different, you have to show remorse, repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regret what you have done, the condition of tawbah, which is to stop, to regret, and not to plan to do that sin again, and you took the rights, if you took the rights for your brothers, you have to return it back. But look at the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again, subhanAllah, then you see how merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, He said, Ya ibadi innakum lan tablughu durri fatadurruni. You're never going to attain, you're never going to be able to harm me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, never ever, never going to be able to harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shows how powerful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no one could ever harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then He said, وَلَن تَبْلُغُوا نَفْعِي فَتَنْفَعُونِي. He said, you're never gonna be able to benefit me at all. So the thing is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who bring the good and remove the hardship. No one can harm Allah, no one can benefit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he said, Ya ibadi, لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم كانوا على أتقى قلب رجل واحد منكم ما زاد ذلك في ملكي شيئا. He said, If all of you, Ya Ibad again, O my slave, all of you, the poor, the rich, the young, the old, males, females, ins and jinn, males and females, if you all upon the heart, or according of the heart of the best of you, so the most pious person, you all upon the iman and taqwa, righteousness, subhanAllah, all of you, like one person, righteous person, said, would not add to anything to my kingdom. Nothing. Nothing would be added to his dominion, subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَا زَادَ ذَٰلِكَ Nothing. So basically, do you think Allah would benefit from our salah? Do you think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would benefit from our zakah, or charity, or siyam, or when you slaughter something? Or when you are kind to your parents, when you are kind to your friends, to your brother, when you maintain, absolutely nothing. He said, this, even if you are the best people, the first and the last, jinn and man, males and females, from the time of Adam till the time of the day of judgment, he said, if you all upon the most righteous heart, then it's not going to benefit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not going to increase his dominion or kingdom, anything, subhanAllah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not benefit from our ibadah. We are the ones benefit from our ibadah. And by His mercy, subhanahu wa ta'ala, He making us benefit out of His ibadah. Then He said, same thing. He said, لو أن أولكم وآخركم وعبادي يا عبادي give my slave. If أولكم وآخركم وأسلكوا الجنة كانوا على أفجر قلب رجل واحد ما نقص ذلك ذلك من ملك شيئا. He said, same thing, the opposite. If you're upon the heart for the first and the last jinn, all of you upon the most wicked hearts. So the worst people, this would not reduce my kingdom anything at all, subhanAllah. All of you kuffar, evil people, will not reduce a single bit of my kingdom. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means. If you are righteous, you'll benefit. If you are misguided, you're going to harm yourself at all. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, He said, O my slaves, shows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the generosity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, Ya ibadi, O my slave, if you all stand, if every single living creature from this instant jinn, whatever you are upon one land. Imagine how many billions there's in the world, subhanAllah, if every single one from the beginning to the last, from the time of Adam till now, till the day of judgment, all of you, not only man, only also jinn. If you all together, subhanAllah, every single one stand there and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for anything you want. And I give each one whatever he have asked for. This asks for a house, this asks for a car, this asks for a plane, this asks for a factory, this why I wanna, whatever. If each single one of you from the day Allah have created Adam till the day of judgment said, will not, said, ما نقص ذلك مما عندي. He said, إلا كما ينقص المخيط من أظهر. Imagine, he said, will not reduce my kingdom at all except as or a needle were dipped in the ocean, subhanAllah. Imagine a needle in the ocean, dipped in the ocean. He said, and take it out, how much water will be reduced from the ocean, mean coming out of the needle, this much. If the whole subhanAllah said, how much water has been reduced from the ocean, if you dipped a needle in the water, and imagine how much water will be taken out, absolutely nothing, because all subhanahu wa ta'ala belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he said, Ya ibadi, the last part, O my slave, innama hiya a'malukum. It's your deeds. Subhanallah, ahsiha lakum. I count it for you. Thumma awafikum iyaha, faman wajda khayran falyahmadillah, wajda ghayra dhalik falayirumunna illa nafsa. He said, your deeds, I count it for you. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, مَا يَلْفِذُ مِنْ قَوْلِ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. He said, every word you utter, subhanAllah, you find a watcher, a recorder, recorded for you. So, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows the justice again, because the beginning of the hadith said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have made dhulam on justice forbidden for him or upon him. So the thing is here, he said, shows here, every, your deeds, you sent forth a good deed, you be rewarded accordingly. You send bad deed, send the good deed, say Alhamdulillah. Because remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you all misguided, unless Allah will know the most Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have guided. So if you were guided, then from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, say Alhamdulillah, because of Allah. If you were misguided, blame yourself. Why? Because you know the right from the wrong. And the thing is, subhanAllah, you blame only yourself, no one else. So this is the beautiful hadith narrated by Abi Dhar al-Ghafari, and this hadith in Sahih Muslim. So authentic hadith.